ओम योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचा मलम शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तम प्रवरम मुनीनाम पतंजलिम प्राञ्जलिदानतोऽस्मि। ओम शांति शांति शांति। हरि ओम तत्सत् श्री रामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु। सो ऑन वेन्सडे वी रीड अप टू 8 सूत्रस फ्रॉम द 3rd चैप्टर ऑफ पतंजलि दर्जयोग and the chapter's name is Vibhutipa. And we explained to you last time that the chapter is so named because these Vibhutis or special powers come as byproducts during our sadhana. The goal set up by Patanjali is by, through penetrative meditation, reach a spot where we have full power of concentration, and we also gain the knowledge that we are Chaitanya separate from Prakriti. And this he takes as the goal. From Vedantic point of view, this is a big step towards the goal. Because ultimately, there is no separate existence of Prakriti. It is the Maya of the Lord with which we are identified with the Lord. So, in the ultimate goal, we shall feel nothing is separate from anything. The whole world is one, and beyond the appearance of the world, there we are, there is God, there is the Purusha, and Purusha is only one in that case. We are today semblance of that Purusha's. Real nature of every one of us, we are not parts. Real nature of every one of us is that very Purusha. This is the ultimate goal we want to reach. But if you are able to perceive that we are consciousness and not Prakriti, this is a very big step. After that perception, we'll have to use that light to go beyond. And this is like seeing our own reflection in the clear mirror. In the clearest mirror of our chitta, we are seeing our own reflection and we feel we have reached it, we have not reached it. What we are seeing is our reflection, and we are the seers. So this difference is not lost. A suspended individual identifying with his own beautiful true reflection is the end of Patanjali's Rajayoga. And this will not allow us to be really free. We explained that day from some of the Gaudapada's observation. In my write-up, I had given you that observations. Today, I repeat. Today's topic is that very topic which is coming. In today's topic, Patanjali repeatedly says that it depends upon sanskara. It depends upon sanskara. And we have to practice, and we have to practice, and we have to practice. So, Gaudapada says in his Karikas that the three things which the Patanjali Yoga promises us, that there will be no further misery, that we shall be free, and that state, he says, their state depends upon the control of the mind. So repeatedly, continuously, we have to practice the control of the mind. The moment we lose our control, we lose all the achievements. And that is not so in Vedanta. When we reach the truth once, it is once for all. When we realize our real nature, that we are Brahman, that we are the one single Purusha of the whole universe, Prakriti is nothing but our appearance. When we reach this goal, the state of mind will change, definitely change. No one can be continuously able to live in Nirvikalp Samadhi. Nobody has done and nobody can. Because that is not the nature of the mind. Mind always changes its states. But the knowledge once gained does not go. When what Vedanta calls as Nirvikalpa Samadhi, where the seer, seen and seeing, they are not three different. In that state we get the full knowledge of what we are. And once the knowledge comes, it will never go. So our mind will change its state, we'll again perceive the world, but we shall not take it to be real. Example we give, Swami Vivekananda has given a beautiful example, practical life. When he was traveling on foot in what is called today Rajasthan, Rajputana it was called in those days. It's a big desert apart from a few handful cities. So he says when he was traveling on foot, he used to see lakes every day. And he used to feel, why people call it desert? There are so beautiful lakes. Now one day when he felt thirsty, he went to one of those lakes to drink water. And what he saw? Sand, not water. And people will tell you that though water was appearing, it will not make the sand even moist. It is fully dry. Now when he got up, he again saw water. But his knowledge is different from perception, please note down. Three states we take. He is seeing water every day and his knowledge is that it is water. Second stage, he saw there is no water. He saw there is only sand. He is not seeing water, not aware of water. He sees sand, aware of sand. And this has given a reflection on his all previous experiences that he was not seeing water. He was seeing an appearance of water. It was sand all the time. Now the third, when he gets up, he again sees water. But his consciousness, his knowledge is that it is sand appearing as water. So that will never go now. He may see water. The Brahmajna Purusha will see the world, he will see all of us. He will see cow and tree, but he knows it is Brahman appearing as cow, Brahman appearing as tree, Brahman appearing as man, woman, Brahman appearing as everything. Apparently, it may be dirty for us, something, but he will not feel it dirty. He will feel it as Brahman. So, that goal once reached will never go. And it cannot go. So please distinguish between the states of the mind and knowledge gained in that state. And take it for granted that state of the mind cannot remain same. That is not the nature of the mind. But what Patanjali proposes, constant practice of samadhi. Samadhi as he calls it. Constantly go. Yes, on Wednesday I had given you a simile. That there is a school of philosophy called Mimamsa. And their idea of liberation is that we'll go to heaven and be happy there. Now we know that heaven is not permanent. They say if we do good karma, we are going to heaven. We continuously will do good karma and go to heaven. Like that, Patanjali's idea is that we shall continuously meditate or concentrate and reach the state where we see we are separate from Prakriti. And when we constantly do it, we are free. And that very thing Gaudapada has pointed out. Their knowledge, their shanti, and their cessation from misery. Three things he has pointed out. The shanti, peace, the cessation of misery, and their knowledge depends upon their control of the mind. The moment control goes away, they lose all these things. Now we can comparatively give a brilliant example. You know, Holy Mother Sarada Devi, most of you have heard that name at least. No, she was the head of a household where one of her niece, Nalini, she quarreled with the husband. She can neither stay with the husband nor leave him. And she used to utter day and night, Ashanti, Ashanti, Ashanti. And mother was head of the family. She says, Nalini always talk of Ashanti. I do not know what is this Ashanti at all, living there. Now, this is the goal we want to reach. Yes, yesterday two people have asked me questions. In our daily life, how to concentrate the mind? In adverse circumstances, how to control the mind? Now, if you reach this state, there is no adverse circumstances. Both physically and universally. Sri Ramakrishna's example, we cannot imagine brighter example. The body was suffering by cancer and he was always in joy. His joy never suffered. Another example in Sri Ramakrishna's life. Once in Bhava Samadhi, he fell down and his bone of the hand slipped. So the doctors put a bandage, lintel, and like this. Now one of his disciples, who later on became Swami Turiyananda, he was Hari, small boy at that time. He came to, when he heard about this, he came to visit him after 3-4 days. And he is asking Sri Ramakrishna, Maharaj, I have asked, there is something happened to your hand. And he is not hiding, he is showing. See how much pain it is there. And doctors have put a bandage, I cannot make it straight also. See how much pain is there. After 5 minutes, this boy says, Maharaj, let it be, let it be. I see you are immersed in bliss. Then Sri Ramakrishna says, this cunning boy has caught me. And this is what Gita has told us, that there will be a state of joy. Not that some people believe, if you are yogis, we'll never have common cold, we'll never have cough, we'll never have mental anxieties. That is not true. We will have all this, and yet our bliss will not go. On the ocean, there are waves on the surface, but if you go deep, there is absolutely calmness. So this peace we want, which does not depend upon our constant practice of anything. We will do constant practice. We will have that much perseverance. Gautama again has said that sitting near an ocean, we are taking a straw and trying to clear the ocean drop by drop. So much perseverance is necessary. But this also has to be done with upaya, by the knowledge that everything as it appears is unreal. In reality, there is only one reality, and that the complete knowledge comes when we know that that very reality appears as all this. Some people ask, why? Gaudapada replied, it is his nature. It is the nature of Brahman to appear through names and forms. Devasya esha svabhavam. Apta kamasya kasbruha. We feel, we do something only when we have some want. And we project this on Brahman, not understanding properly. Why Brahman is? What is the meaning of why? We are assuming there is something else than Brahman. We are assuming that that can have some effect on Brahman. We are assuming that Brahman will change. And then we are asking why. So this question of why is nonsense, is irrational. Gaudapada says it is his nature to appear as through names and forms. In Maharashtra, there has been a big saint called Gyaneshwar Maharaj. He says, I do not know that Brahman through avidya appears as this and that. No. It is Brahman's nature to appear. Avidya is ours, that we are taking this to be real. There is no avidya in Brahman. So, I think I made it fully clear today. Now, in that scheme, From the right day one, question was asked of me, why Patanjali? Swamikanda has made it very clear in the very preface of Patanjali Sutras. Though we have philosophical differences from Patanjali, we accept his methods. Shankaracharya has the same thing, that we accept yoga as some methods. And that is why I remember that when I was dealing with the second chapter, all of you were so happy. Smoothly the classes went on because it was sadhanapad, because it was dealing only with methods and means. There were no quarrel with Patanjali. Anyway, so I made my position today very clear. Let me take up some sutras also. The main point was this. I had told a little about this and I had given in my write-up. In the first or second lecture, I had explained this. But today, after the completion of second chapters, and when we are coming to this Vibhuti path, and when we are coming to what Patanjali calls Kaivalya, Kaivalya will talk in fourth chapter. So, at this point, I thought I should make my position clear. I should make the Vedantic position clear. But because the methods are important, and also because I felt that the limitations of Patanjali Sutra should be pointed out, I undertook this course of lectures. So, now we read up to eight sutras. What were the eight sutras? That dharana, the central point. Now, Patanjali changes its names many times. We will come to we will come to 11, where he talks of samadhi, and that will appear same as dharana. Anyway, so there is no difference of quality in dharana, dhyana and samadhi. All these three are, he says, antaranga. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara were different categories. But dharana, dhyana, samadhi, intensification of dharana is dhyana, intensification of dhyana is samadhi. So, dharana means absolute concentration on a particular spot to the exclusion of everything else. Now, another beauty, I will tell of Patanjali now, another beauty. Vedanta will tell us, meditation. What is meditation? On your own self, from the beginning. From the beginning, Vedantic meditation is on God, who is our own self. Vedantic meditation is on our own self. It is difficult for some people. Patanjali proposes you meditate on anything you like, anything you like. And the beauty is that through that concentration, meditation or Patanjali is concentration. Through that concentration, you get a penetrative insight. First, you are able to perceive the subtle entities behind the spot or object which you are concentrating upon. If you continue that concentration, automatically your attention will go to your own mind. You are concentrating outside. But property of concentration, the characteristic of concentration, the Patanjali's penetrative concentration will automatically lead you to the internal organ called mind and buddhi. This he has told in the Samprajnata Samadhi. So, vitarka, vichara, ananda, asmita. Ananda was concentration on our own mind and body, not separately, huh? As a continuation of concentration on any external point, the mind will automatically revert and see its own self and concentrate on that. That is the beauty of Patanjali, I would say. And then it will reach further that point which Patanjali calls asmita. That means we are able to see I consciousness separate from Prakriti. And then he says, this is all Samprajnata Samadhi. So this is not the goal. This is not even the method of the goal. But this has given us two things. The power of the mind and the knowledge that we are separate from Prakriti. This is use this power and this knowledge to restrain all waves arising in the mind. And in the beginning he has declared yoga chitta vritti nirodha tada drashtu sarupe avasthanam. So, chitta vritti nirodha is the goal, not concentration. But by concentration, we have got that power of the mind. And with penetrative concentration, we have reached that knowledge in which we can know that we are separate from Prakriti. Using these two, we restrain the waves of the mind. And he has told in the beginning itself, don't try directly for restraining the waves of the mind. You will not reach your goal. You will get a high position, maybe a god, one of the gods, or you will become identified with the whole Prakriti. And next time, in the next kalpa, you will be given the charge of directing the Prakriti. But if we want to get freedom or mukti, don't go that way. First, step by step, attain the samprajnata samadhi, which comes by these steps. Vitarka, concentration on gross objects. It will lead to the subtler perception. Then concentrate on the subtle objects, it's called savichara. Then it will lead you to perceive your own mind and buddhi. Then concentrate on that. It will lead you to perceive your eye consciousness. Then concentrate on that. It will reveal ritam bharatatra pragya, knowledge based upon truth. And then use these two things to restrain any wave rising from the mind. Now the problem comes when we restrain. Patanjali accepts that. When we restrain an impression, a wave, because restrain of the mind is a mental effort. Mental effort is a wave. So, tadya sanskara, anya sanskara pratibandhi. That means it does not allow other waves to rise, but there is always a wave of restraining. Now, when we are constantly practicing it, it leaves sanskara or impressions. So, this will always remain. And that is why he wants us to practice continuously. We will always have the Nirodha Sanskar, the impressions of restraining. We will not see any wave there. But the inner content of the wave, the subtlest form of the wave, which is Sanskar, will always be there. And then he says, I am speaking to you randomly, not sutra by sutra. Tasya prashanta vahita sanskara. That means it will become steady flow by practice. Practice living sanskaras, continuous practice living continuous sanskaras, and that is how it will gain a steady flow. So the whole picture given by Patanjali is clear, constantly practice. Now, so dharana was the central point. Dhyana was the further process. Samadhi was deepest concentration, samprajnata samadhi. And there also he said that step by step you should practice. Now the process itself is step by step, but he says, practice first on gross objects, then on subtle objects, then on your mind, then on your eye consciousness. Tasya bhumishu vinayoga. And then in the seventh he said, trayam antarangam purvebhya. Compared to yamaniyamasan pranayam pratyahar, their outer means, these are inner means. Tadapi bahirangam nirbijasya. But he wants nirbija, though he calls it nirbija. That means what he calls asamprajnata or nirbija, waveless state of the mind. Compared to that, they are also outside. This deepest concentration compared to the waveless state is outside. Then, now we read a little the ninth sutra. Little involved language is there, I will clear it for you. Yuthana nirodha sanskarayoho abhibhava pradurbhavo nirodha kshana chittanvayo nirodha parinama. Parinama means modification of the mind. So it is a way of modification of the mind. When is it called restrained modification? When is it called nirodha, which he wants us to do chitta vritti nirodha? Now in the first clause of the sentence, it is to split yuthana sanskara your abhibhava. Yuthana sanskarasya abhibhava. Nirodha sanskarasya pradurbhava. Yuthana means the restless state of the mind. Yuthana means when there are waves in the mind. That Patanjali calls yuthana. In Vedanta, the meaning of yuthana is different. That we are not in Nirvikal Samadhi now, but with that knowledge we are coming back. But in Patanjali, Vyuthan means waves are in the mind. Now, waves are in the mind has to be suppressed, abhibhava, overpowered. The Vyuthana sanskara abhibhava. There are sanskaras of Vyuthana and they have been controlled or overpowered. Nirodha sanskara pradurbhava. Then another type of sanskaras have come, nirodha sanskara. The deepest impression of restraining, that has come now. And the sanskara of restraining have arisen, pradurbhava means arisen. The yuthana sanskara, wave states of the mind, has been suppressed or overpowered, and the restraining sanskaras have arisen. Nirodha kshana chittanvayo. This kshana term should not confuse us. It is not a moment. It is not a second. Kshana means now what has come? Our mind is in nirodha. So kshana means all the time that it is in nirodha. The meaning of nirodha kshana is nirodha kshana, as you may take it plural. You may take kshana to mean here the time, full time, in which we are under the nirodha sanskara, deepest impressions of restraining the mind. That is called nirodha. So he makes it very clear. Restraining nirodha parinama. The modification of the mind called nirodha happens when there is a constant practice of the nirodha sanskara all the time, nirodha kshana. It's also clear, when it is lost, it is gone. Nirodha kshana is gone, yuthana kshana has come. So, when yuthana kshana has been overpowered and nirodha kshana is continuing, that is called kshana. When nirodha kshana is continuing, chitta anvayo, our mind is in that state. Our mind is in that state where nirodha sanskar is continuing. That is called nirodha. Patanjali says, this is nirodha. The nirodha type of modification of the mind is this. And there he says this sutra which I told previously, tasya prashanta vahita sanskara. Vahita, that means there is a flow. Prashanta vahita, steady flow. Tasya means nirodha sanskarasya prashanta vahita. The restrained sanskaras or sanskaras of restrainment will have a steady flow, sanskaras, by practice and practice. By practice living sanskaras, that will make that steady flow. That is what Patanjali says. Then, definition of samadhi in Patanjali. In various places, he gives various definitions. Now listen to this definition. सर्वार्थता एकाग्रतयो क्षयोदयो चित्तस्य समाधि परिणामा. हियर ऑल्सो द क्लॉज इज डबल्ड वे सेपरेट. सर्वार्थता क्षयो एकाग्रतया उदयो. That means when we are not controlled, then mind is undertaking all impressions of the world. The vrittis are throughout the world or on a larger area or wherever it is going. Chayo. When that has subsided, when that has become weak or powerless or subsided, ekagra yo udayo, one-pointedness has arisen. The many-pointedness has subsided, one-pointedness has arisen. He said that is the samadhi modification of the chitta. Is it not his previous definition of dharana the same? Where he says we have to concentrate on a point to the exclusion of all other points? Anyway, we say success is samadhi now. When this dharana continues, and we are really able to hold on to one point, it is samadhi. Okay. So, samadhi definition is the mental wave, parinam. The modification of the mind called samadhi is that where mind scattered is gone, mind ekagra only remains. This is samadhi. Now, as I told you, samadhi has so many connotations. When I try to look in standard dictionaries, 17 meanings of samadhi they have given. So, we are not interested in those, but we are interested in the definitions in Vedanta and Rajayoga. Last lecture at the end point, question was asked of me, and there I explained this to some extent. Samadhi in Vedanta is of two types. Savikalpa and Nirvikalpa. Savikalpa is of various types. The Bhakta Savikalpa is that I am God's son, I am God's father, I am God's mother. Any relation in the world you can hold with God. And the world does not exist. It is samadhi because my mind is absorbed in the thought of God only, to the exclusion of all other types of thought, not all other spots. My mind is absorbed in the thought of God to the exclusion of all other thoughts, all other types of thoughts, so it is samadhi. But it is savikalpa because I am there. Something other than God is there. The jnani savikalpa samadhi is aham brahmasmi. There also, he is identified with the reflection. Aham brahmasmi is not the goal. I am the son of God is not the goal. But that is just the previous step of nirvikalpa samadhi. What happens in nirvikalpa samadhi? When I understand that my joy, my love will not go away. My joy, my love, my identity will grow if I lose myself. If I lose my separate identity, then this will grow. And then a flash comes. I cannot forget. Repeatedly my guru used to tell me. Then a flash comes and this I goes away. That is nirvikalpa samadhi in Vedanta. When the seer, seen and seeing do not remain separate, only the knowledge remains. Now in this state, even if you go for a second, you are released. If you remain there for say few minutes, you are released. When you come back, what happens to you? In Upanishad beautifully describes it. Pratibodha viditam matam. That means in every wave of your consciousness, you will feel God. God as me. God is drinking. Drinking is God. God is milk. And such a state of realization has been described beautifully in the Taittiriya Upanishad. another thing is that so much joy is there, endless, endless, infinite joy. So when a sadhak reaches that state, he sings according to Taittiriya Upanishad. And what he sings? In the beginning, he does not express anything. Ha, woo, ha, woo, ha, woo. Expression of joy is simple. And then he says, I am the food, I am the food, I am the food. I am the eater, I am the eater, I am the eater. And I am the eating, which is the interrelation between the food and eater is eating. I am the eating, I am the eating, I am the eating. Now this is Vedantic knowledge. That just outside Nirvikalpa Samadhi, he feels I am everything. No difference at all between anything. So all this talk of enjoyment and where it will stand? No grihna will stand. No kaam or krodh will stand. No moha will stand. Because all has become one. So this is the Vedantic Samadhi. I think I made it very clear now. Patanjali Samadhi is when ekagrata continues, it is called Samadhi. When anekagrata goes away and ekagrata continues, it is Samadhi. Now, in this ekagrata, there are two things. I am ekagra on something. I am ekagra on something. So, I am there and ekagrata is there. In Vedanta, when this I also is lost, then that is real Samadhi. Anyway, now, what is ekagrata? Because he has used the word ekagrata in 11th sutra, he has to define that ekagrata again. Yanto ditau tulya pratyayo chittasya ekagrata parinama brotima. Patanjali's description of mental state is simply fantastic. Here, in two books, two parts are there. In some books, tata puna shanto ditau tulya pratyayo chittasya ekagrata parinama. Tatapuna means, as ekagrata has been mentioned in the previous sutra, in that case, tatapuna means, again in that case. Shanta pratyaya, udita pratyaya. That means mind is always in waves. Huh? One wave has subtracted, another has risen. This is mind. Now, the wave which has subsided and which has arisen, both are of similar type. They say ekagrata. I have concentrated on a spot to the exclusion of other spots. One wave comes, then it subsides. Another wave comes, I am on that spot. It subsides. Another wave comes, I am on that spot. So, it continues. So, when different waves coming in succession are similar, he does not say same, are similar, because that wave has gone, another wave has arisen. Waves are always continuously flowing. Waves cannot be constant anytime. As he has explained before, the impressions, sanskaras of the waves are there, but wave is always changing. But the changing waves have the same pattern. The changing wave has the same thing in mind. That is the ekagrata. Similar thing. Now through ekagrata we are entered in perceiving the subtle thing. Again we are perceiving the subtle thing. Again we are our perceptions are not constant. They are made of successive waves. Why we feel constancy? Example is given of the cinema show. In cinema, these days more development might have come. 1/16th of a second, one picture stays on the screen. In 1 second, 16 frames or pictures have gone. But there is a screen. Because of the screen, the 16 pictures do not appear broken, they appear to be continuous. A man is waving his hand. Now in 16 positions, that picture is taken. But it appears continuous because of the constant screen. This is similarly here. Waves are waves are waves. But when the waves are of the same type, it is called ekagrata. Etena bhuta indriyeshu dharma lakshana avastha parinama vyakhyata. Here I'll use some technical terms. Etena means by this explanation. By this explanation. Explanation of Nirodha, Samadhi and Ekagrata. Bhuta Indriyeshu Dharma Lakshana Avastha Parinama Vyakhyata. Bhuta means matter. Now this is all about our perception. Matter is not changing. But our concentration of the mind, instead of the matter, we are going to the subtle thing. That is called Dharma Parinama. Instead of the subtle matter, we come across our own mind. So this change of the characteristic, gross becoming subtle, subtle becoming our own mind becoming our eye consciousness, becoming in our perception. We are perceiving gross, but by the ekagrata samadhi, we have penetrated it, we are perceiving the subtle. Then we are perceiving this, we are perceiving that. This is called dharma parinam, the change in characteristics of matter and also our indriyas. Because the concentration is through indriyas, it comes back to indriyas. And indriyas are perceived again as gross or subtle or mind only or buddhi only. So the dharma lakshana, change of form, dharma means form. The change of form in matter and our indriyas is explained by as our experience through concentration. Etena, by these three concentration process, we have explained to you how matter changes to subtle and subtle to indriyas and indriyas change to ourself in our perception. Then lakshana parinam, this technical term, lakshana means related to time. The commentators will tell us, lakshana means related to time. Now, I am seeing gross. After some time, I am seeing subtle. After some time, I am perceiving my indriyas and my mind. So, the change of form accompanied by change of time. Change of form accompanied by change of time in which I am perceiving. All these are perceptions in which I am perceiving is called lakshana parinam. Parinam is happening in matter or our indriyas. I perceived my matter now. After any concentration, instead of matter, I perceived subtle objects. This is change of form, but it has happened after some time. So it is called lakshana parinam. After some time, I have pursued my indriyas, I have pursued my mind. So it is called lakshana parinam. Then there is third, avastha parinam. Avastha parinam means state of my mind has changed. And so we have changed the matter has changed, matter has gone. Certain things are gone. My mind has gone. I am perceiving Purusha. So the states are totally changed. So the change of state also is explained by more and more concentration. This was the 13th sutra. Now what is constant? I think enough for though it took a little disturbance today, I think our time is up now. We'll take up this 14th sutra. Though it depends upon the 13th, we'll take it up in our Monday class. Again, I'm sorry. There was some mistake with my computer. The internet got lost. I had to shift the place where Wi-Fi was working. And so, there was a deception. ॐ योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचा मलम शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तम प्रवरम मुनीनाम पतंजलिम प्राञ्जलिदा नतोस्मि ओम शांति 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 हरि ओम तत्सत श्री रामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु।